In this video, I'm going to show you how to add digital LED strip into Home Assistant using ESP Home, like this. Now make sure you stick around, and if you like what you see, hit subscribe so you don't miss out on future videos. Hi, I'm Will from Will Surrey Tech. Today I'm going to take you through all the steps in integrating a digital LED strip into Home Assistant using ESP Home. First, we're going to look at the WS2812B LED strip. Then we're looking at some simple circuitry to connect it to a Wemos D1 Mini. After that, we'll flash it with ESP Home before finally integrating it into Home Assistant so we can play with effects or use it in automations. If you stick around until the end, I'll show you a very simple automation that I've created for mine, which lets me know when my phone battery gets too low. So, what is 2812B digital LED strip? Well, let's break it down. LED strip is a strip with LEDs on it. It is used when you want to create a long line of light, so it can be used in ceilings of big open spaces like warehouses or garages, or on countertops. It is often used to replace fluorescent tubes because it's safer and cheaper to run. Now there are two main types of LED strip, digital and analog. First, let's look at analog. It's very simple. It has a common power and then three channels for three colours, red, green and blue. Depending on how much power you send down each of these three channels, depends on the colour you get out. The downside of analog LED strip is the whole strip needs to be the same colour. So in comes digital. There are many different types of digital LED strip, and Rob from The Hookup has an excellent video detailing them all. But in a nutshell, each LED has its own microchip built into it to tell the LED what colour it needs to be when it receives a data signal. Now I've chosen the WS2812B digital LED strip, WS2812B being the name of the microchip within the LEDs, because of a few reasons. It's 5 volts, which means it can run on the same power supply that I'm using to run my Wemos D1 Mini. It's cheap, and it also is compatible with the libraries that we're going to be using later to run it. The LED strip has 3 cables going to it. A red for 5 volts, a white for ground, and a green for data. It also has a spare red and white cable for power injection. Because we're doing such a short run today, we're going to ignore that. But if you're doing a longer run, then you want to inject power every 5 meters or so to keep your LEDs constant and so they have enough power to run. Now that's enough of the boring stuff. Let's get on with the project. To do this project, you're going to need WS2812B LED strip, something to cut your LED strip to length, a Wemos D1 Mini. You can use a different ESP8266 controller if you wish, and a micro USB power supply. You're also going to need some jumpers. Depending on your manufacturer will depend on which jumpers you need, but I needed male to female. I didn't have any lying around, so I've made one using the connector cable that the company provided with the LED strip. Now this is an all-in-one cable, so if you're going to make one like this, make sure you get the pins in the right order. It needs to be 5 volts, ground, and then data in order to connect it to the D1 Mini. If your D1 Mini comes without pins attached, then you're also going to need a soldering iron to attach your header pins. It's generally cheaper to get them without pins attached if you're happy to do a bit of soldering. I got my LED strip from Amazon, but if you're willing to wait a little longer, you can get it from eBay or AliExpress for much cheaper. First, you're going to need to look at the power consumption of your LED strip so you can decide the power supply. You can use the table from the hookups video to tell you how much power your LEDs are going to use. He says it's going to be 0.18 watts per single LED. I'm using 1 meter of LED strip, so that's 60 LEDs. That means I'm going to be drawing 10.8 watts, and at 5 volts, that's 2.16 amps. My power supply is rated to 2.5 amps, so that will be fine. When I first heard about ESP8266 microcontrollers, I went for the cheapest one I could find, the ESP01S. I'd highly recommend you don't do this. These chips run on 3.3 volts, which means you either need to buy or build an adapter to run them from USB at 5 volts. They also don't accept serial via USB, because they don't have a USB port, so you've got to buy a USB serial to TTL converter. For just a couple of pounds more, you can get the Wemos D1 Mini, which has USB power and USB serial built in, so you can flash it really easily. The first thing I need to do is solder the header pins onto my D1 Mini. As you can see, mine came with three different types of header pins, but for this case I'm just going to use the male-to-male ones and solder them on. Next, we need to connect our LED strip to the controller. We need to connect the red cable to 5 volts, the white cable to ground, and the green cable to a data pin. I'm using pin D4 because it's next to the 5 volts and ground. Now we head over to Home Assistant. You're going to need to make sure you have the ESP Home add-on installed. So if you head over to the Supervisor tab, go to the Add-ons page, and then search for ESP Home, it'll appear there. Once you've clicked Install, you can open the web UI. I have mine in the sidebar for ease of access later on. Once we're in the ESP Home add-on, you click on the plus. Here you can enter the name of your device. Make sure you're only using lower cases and don't use any spaces. Click Next and select the board type. We're using the Wemos D1 Mini. Click Next again and enter your Wi-Fi details. Once you've clicked Finish, you'll need to flash it. Once up and running, you'll be able to re-flash it over the air or through your Wi-Fi. But for the first time, we need to plug it in. So if you plug your D1 Mini into your computer using the USB now. You're supposed to be able to flash over USB using the add-on, but I've never managed to get it to detect the device. So I use a tool called ESP Home Flasher. Now to use this, we're going to need to compile and download the binary. Click on the three dots next to your new device and click Compile. It may take a while, but when it's done, you can click Download Binary. From here, you need to open up the new app, ESP Home Flasher, and select the serial port that your device is connected to. It should automatically select it, but if you have multiple devices plugged in, you'll need to choose the correct one here. You now need to click Browse and select the new .bin file from your downloads, and click Flash. It may take a while to flash it, but once it's done, it will give you the Wi-Fi information and say Setup Finished. Now I have all the devices on my network on a static IP address, so I'm going to set that up now in the router and then restart the router and my D1 Mini. Now we go back to the ESP Home add-on and refresh the page. We should see our device listed as online. Now we need to go to the ESP Home website, and you can see here that there are so many different devices you can integrate with your microcontrollers. We want lights, so we're going to scroll down to lights and click Fast LED. Once here, we can scroll down and see that the WS2812B is compatible with Fast LED. So we're going to copy the YAML from above, and we need to go back into our Home Assistant add-on, click on Edit next to our new device, and we can be editing the YAML for our device. We paste it at the bottom, and we need to edit a few things here. First, we want to edit the chip. We're using the WS2812B chip. Now we change the pin. I'm using pin D4. Next is the number of LEDs. I've got 60 LEDs in my 1 meter strip. Now we change the RGB order. In this case, we want it to be GRB. You may find that this is wrong for your particular LED strip, so this is where you'd change it if you turned on blue and it came out red, for example. Lastly, we can call it a name. This is what will come up when we use Home Assistant later. We save it, validate it, and once we're sure the YAML is correct, we upload it. Again, this may take a while as we're integrating some new libraries and packages. Once we see the purple Wi-Fi information, we can close the window and move on to integrating into Home Assistant. We go to the Configurations page and click Integrations. Once here, your device should appear at the top. But if not, don't worry, you click on the plus and search for ESP Home. We now insert the host name. This is what you called your device in the first case. So for my case, it's cave_LED. You then add .local. So cave_LED.local. The port should be correct, so we click Next and select an area we want this device to be in. Click Finish and your device should appear in the integrations. If you click through on your integrations, you'll be able to turn it on and off and change the colour of it. You might be thinking, hold on, I can only control the entire strip. And you'd be right. So now what we're going to look at is adding effects to our LEDs. If we go back to the ESP Home website, we can see that effects is an option we could add. Here we can click on Light Effects and scroll and see some various examples that we can use. I'm going to copy and paste a few of these examples into my cave_LED.yaml file back in my add-on. I'm just going to use some of the demo effects that they have listed. But you can create your own or just edit the numbers in some of theirs. Once we're happy, we save, validate, and upload our configuration file. Once done, we can see some of our new effects in action. If we go back to the integrations page, we can see them listed and we can select them. Because I've decided to mount the LED strip in a visible location, I've decided to use some aluminium channel. I'd highly recommend this as it gives a much nicer finish when the LEDs are off and it diffuses the light when they're on. It's very easy to install. You just attach the fixings it comes with to the surface you're trying to mount to. I'm using one at each end and one in the middle. You stick the LED strip down the center of the channel, pop in the diffuser, and then attach the channel into the mountings. After a little bit of cable management, you can turn it on and enjoy your handiwork. I said I'd show you how I use this in an automation, so here we go. Let's dive into Node Red. I like to keep my automations as tidy as possible, so we're going to go over to the Lighting tab. First, we're going to copy and paste this description node so we can label what this automation does. Then I'm adding an event state node, using the entity of my phone's battery sensor. You can find your entity names in the Developers tab. Next, we're going to choose an output node. So now we set it up. We're triggering a light, we want it to turn on, and we want to set the entity to the entity of the light that we've just created. Now, if we go into the data, we can edit the JSON to select the effect that we want to use. I'm going to be triggering a rainbow effect in this case. I'm going to test this integration by adding an inject node to the call service. We connect it up and we can deploy. Now we can eject and it should trigger the rainbow effect that we're looking to see. I'm going to add a condition for this automation. It's going to be a get state node for my cave switch. Basically, it means the trigger only happens if I'm at my desk, i.e. the cave switch is on. Once we're happy, we link it all up, deploy, and we can sit back and relax while we wait for our automation to happen. If you like what you saw today, make sure you click subscribe so you can find out more about my tech and how you can build yourself the ultimate smart home.